Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sherman's March, the first full-length narrative of General William T. Sherman's devastating march through Georgia and the Carolinas, by Burke Davis, narrated by Joe Barrett. 1. He believes in hard war. From a window of a brick house on the hill, a bearded face peered across the burning heart of Atlanta. It was a face incredibly wrinkled and furrowed, dominated by a ruddy scimitar of a nose and a broad mouth that writhed about the stump of a cigar as the tall man spoke to those in the room behind him. General William T. Sherman glanced restlessly about, squinting toward a setting sun now obscured by smoke, to the courthouse and Masonic Hall, still undamaged, into an inferno of blazing railroad shops, depots, and factories, and along streets patrolled by federal sentries who were under Sherman's orders to save churches and private homes. Scorching heat pulsed against the columned mansion where Sherman made his headquarters, and in the growing darkness, the glare lighted the countryside so brightly that soldiers in camps a mile from the city could read their letters from home. Exploding shells burst in the ruins of captured Confederate arsenals, shaking the house and rattling shrapnel against its walls. It was November 15, 1864. Sherman's troops, some 62,000 strong, had already begun to evacuate the burning city. By the next morning, they would be off on a thousand-mile foray through the heart of the reeling Confederacy that would leave a path of destruction 80 miles wide, pillage three state capitals, and bring an end to the war that had racked the nation for 3 years. The general rubbed the thinning thatch of his hair upward with both hands, tugged at his blouse buttons, drummed the windowsill with his fingers, seized the cigar, snapped furiously at its ashes, and replaced it, puffing in a fury, shooting smoke from his mouth like pistol fire, as if it were the last cigar in the world. His soldiers had often seen him in such a state, picking nervously at himself with fluttering fingers. One of them said, "I never saw him, but I thought of Lazarus." The city that he had so recently captured seemed to Sherman a symbol of Confederate resistance. "Atlanta," he said abruptly, "I've been fighting Atlanta all this time. It's done more to keep up the war than any, well, Richmond, perhaps. All the guns and wagons we've captured along the way all marked Atlanta." He was determined that the city would no longer serve as a major Confederate supply center. He had captured Atlanta on September 2nd, after one of the war's most brilliant campaigns, and 6 weeks later was now to leave it behind, ungarrisoned, to lead his troops on a march that was to bring him military immortality. Sherman turned into the room, gesturing to his officers with his cigar stump baton. "They've done so much to destroy us, we've got to destroy Atlanta, at least enough to stop any more of that." No one, not even the most devoted of his staff, could imagine that Sherman was on the threshold of fame tonight. He strode to the dining table and sank into a mahogany chair as awkwardly as if he were straddling a cracker box, his customary seat in the field. Sherman was a slight, almost frail figure of deceptively wiry strength. He wore no badge of rank. His weather-stained blouse looked as if he had slept in it for 3 years of war. He wore a dirty dickie with wilted points, a faded gray flannel shirt, muddy brown trousers, older than the memory of his most veteran staff officer, low-cut shoes rather than boots, and but one spur, the only general of either army who affected shoes and a single spur. Sherman's headquarters would have done justice to a bandit chief. It traveled in a single wagon, including baggage for all clerks, aides, and orderlies. "I think it's as low down as we can get," he said. He scorned elaborate equipment hauled along by comfort-seeking officers as a farce. Nothing but poverty will cure it. There had been only three aides, though two others had come recently, one of them Major Henry Hitchcock, a young Republican lawyer from St. Louis, who was assigned to handle a correspondence that had begun to overwhelm the general. "Just tell him something sweet, Hitchcock. You know, honey and molasses." Hitchcock had been completely won over by Sherman at their first meeting. Despite the general's eccentricities, the young lawyer found him straightforward, simple, kind-hearted, nay, warm-hearted, scrupulously just, and careful of the rights of others. Above all, Hitchcock was impressed with Sherman's competence. "You may be sure of one thing. What he says he can do, he can." Tonight the general's meal was as simple as those of his interminable marches: hardtack, sweet potatoes, bacon, and coffee. Sherman gnawed at a flinty piece of hardtack and began his familiar lecture on its virtues, halted to greet a dispatch bearer, ripped open a message, and barked out a reply. He talked of the enemy, of Southern women, of U.S. Grant and President Lincoln, heedlessly gulping his food, then returning to the smoldering cigar, still talking and laughing, giving orders, dictating telegrams. Bright and chipper, one of his generals noted. He cut short others who spoke and went on with his hurried comments, refusing to be interrupted. "I'm too red-haired to be patient," he had said. A war correspondent described him as he was at this moment. He walked, talked, or laughed all over. He perspired thought at every pore, pleasant and affable, engaging, with a mood that shifted like a barometer in a tropic sea. The meal was ended by a regimental band from Massachusetts, blaring beneath the windows in a serenade to the general, the brasses pealing incongruously above the explosions and roaring flames. Sherman listened briefly, lost interest, and turned back to dispatch bearers and officers who had come for orders. After a few lively military tunes, the band played the Miserere from Il Trovatore, whose melancholy beauty, Henry Hitchcock thought, would forever remind him of this November night of roaring flames when Atlanta was destroyed and the army began its march to the sea. Drunken Federal soldiers had been setting fires in the stricken city for several days in defiance of Sherman's orders, but the official work of destruction had begun only when two Michigan regiments knocked down the massive stone roundhouse with improvised battering rams, placed powder charges under large buildings, and piled mountains of worn-out wagons, tents, and bedding in the railroad depot, ready for the torch. Sherman had ordered the city's destruction postponed until this night of November 15th. A foundry, an oil refinery, and a freight warehouse were burned first. The blazing depot square spread a storm of fire. The Atlanta Hotel, Washington Hall, dry goods stores, theaters, the fire stations and jail, slave markets, went up in flames. A mine exploded in a stone warehouse. Old pine timbers burned with astonishing brilliance and flung brands in all directions. The sun shone blood red through a thickening cloud. The air for miles about was oppressive and intolerable. By night, the burning city was the grandest and most awful scene, with fires towering hundreds of feet into the sky. Hitchcock watched in fascination. First bursts of smoke, dense black volumes, then tongues of flame, then huge waves of fire roll up into the sky. Presently, the skeletons of great warehouses stand out in relief against sheets of roaring, blazing, furious flames. As one fire sinks, another rises, lurid, angry, dreadful to look upon. The fires died down before midnight, and the glare began to fade. Hitchcock saw that the courthouse and Masonic Hall still stood. No private homes within view of headquarters had been burned, but tomorrow, he thought, when the guards are gone, all would go up in smoke. Already bands of drunken Federal soldiers raced through the streets on foot and horseback, smashing plate glass windows, bearing huge loads of uniforms from army warehouses, and selling them on street corners for any price they could get. Sherman's troops gathered before large buildings and shouted and danced and sang while pillar and roof and dome sank into one common ruin. A bitter stench filled the night. Odors of pine, tar, gunpowder, oil, charred meat and cloth, leather, carpets, feather beds, hot metal, burned privies, hospital sheds, hotels, drugstores, and from the streets themselves, the sickening smell of dead horses and mules. Some of Sherman's soldiers watched the sea of flames in dismay. Harvey Reed, a 23-year-old Wisconsin schoolteacher in the 20th Corps, wrote indignantly, "This destruction of private property in Atlanta was entirely unnecessary and therefore a disgraceful piece of business. The cruelties practiced on this campaign toward citizens have been enough to blast a more sacred cause than ours. We hardly deserve success." And Major James Austin Connolly, who rode near the head of an Illinois regiment, blamed Sherman himself for the needless destruction of the city. He is somewhere nearby now, looking on at all this, and saying not one word to prevent it. Major Connolly would have been surprised to learn that Sherman spent most of this night with his engineers in the streets trying to help save threatened houses. The general worked while his wagons, guns, and troops were moving eastward from the city. By dawn, some 200 acres of Atlanta lay in ashes. The only survivors were 400 houses and a few larger buildings, most of them churches. Father Thomas O'Reilly of the Church of the Immaculate Conception, who had assembled a guard of federal soldiers, saved his church and parsonage and nearby houses, as well as the City Hall and St. Philip's Episcopal, Trinity Methodist, Second Baptist, and Central Presbyterian churches. Atlanta Medical College was saved by another resolute Confederate, Dr. Peter Paul Noel d'Alvigny, a French Army veteran who hoodwinked the enemy. When his last patients were evacuated, federal soldiers spread straw on the floors of the buildings, ready for the torch. D'Alvigny bribed hospital attendants to pose as patients and protested to a federal officer that he must have time to move his wounded. "You have no patients. The place is empty, and it burns tonight with the rest of them. Those are my orders." The doctor led him to an upper room where his hospital attendants lay groaning in a distressing display of helplessness. "All right," the bewildered officer said. "I'll give you until sunrise to get him out of here." The last of the army was moving out by dawn, and the medical college survived, overlooked in the haste of departure. In the last hours, federal soldiers looted the city in company with Confederate deserters and a few civilians who hurried into pillage. Bluecoats robbed warehouses of uniforms, tobacco, and whiskey, put on Confederate gray, stuffed their pockets with foot-long plugs of tobacco, and drank the whiskey. The 14th Corps, last to leave the city, began to move at sunrise, marching past a vacant lot where civilians crouched among piles of household goods they had snatched from the flames. Chaplain John Height of the 58th Indiana carried a memory of women wringing their hands in agony, some of them praying aloud. How far these people are deserving of pity, it is hard to tell. Sherman left Atlanta at 7 in the morning of November 16th, riding his favorite mount, Sam, a blaze-faced little horse whose horribly fast walk was the dismay of his staff. The general was erect and vigorous in the saddle, like a gamecock, some of his men thought. His face was drawn with fatigue and half concealed by a broad-brimmed hat jammed down over his ears, a formless black hat worn without braid or tassels. The sunlight revealed streaks of gray in the cinnamon beard. Sherman's cigar rolled constantly across his mouth, even as he talked with staff officers and his bodyguard of Alabama cavalry, waving and gesturing with his slender, feminine hands. His nose twitched, as if the general were snuffling out the trail ahead, a relic of his long bouts with asthma. He had burned niter papers in his room for years, until the southern climate had cured him. The general was watchful as he rode among his troops, missing nothing as he passed. Illinois artillerymen breaking camp, furiously discarding surplus equipment, squabbling over hatchets, stew pans, and coffee pots to be taken, each officer reduced to a grip sack and blanket and canvas tent about the size of a large towel. A Minnesota regiment stuffing the stringy flesh of freshly killed beeves into knapsacks, bellowing in protest, "Blue jerk! $13 a month and blue jerk!" Quartermasters snatching stores from flames that had freshly sprung up, flinging boots, coats, and trousers onto the passing column. The 86th Illinois Infantry, its men calling in unison as they marched, "Split peas, split peas!" Victims of a commissary officer who had no other rations left to him, men who knew they must cook the peas 3 hours tonight. Whiskey had been issued, and many had drawn double rations. Hosea Rood of Wisconsin saw these men begin as if they would reach the sea by nightfall. They stepped high and long, they sang and made merry, and could not for the life of them see why the glorious march had not begun a long time before. Every private seemed to know the army's destination, though Sherman's orders had told them little of what was to come. "It is sufficient for you to know that it involves a departure from our present base and a long and difficult march." They would carry few supplies, live off the country, and forage liberally. Soldiers were forbidden to enter houses along the route, though they might take food they saw in the open, crops and livestock and all else, and should plunder hostile, rich Southerners rather than the poor. Able-bodied Negroes could be taken along, but not so many as to burden the columns. Enemy country was to be devastated only where the army met resistance by Confederate guerrillas. The general had reassured the army that its passage through enemy country could be made safely. All the chances of war have been considered and provided for, as far as human sagacity can. All he, Sherman, asks of you is to maintain that discipline, patience, and courage which have characterized you in the past, and he hopes, through you, to strike a blow at the enemy that will have a material effect in producing what we all so much desire, his complete overthrow. Recruits who cheered the general on the first day's march were quieted by veterans who had followed him for years. He don't like it. But today, for some reason, Sherman seemed to welcome the cries of his troops. He waved and grinned when others called, "Guess Grant's waiting for us at Richmond, Uncle Billy." He passed within 10 feet of a drunken soldier who scowled up at him, cursing the general with a steady vehemence. Sherman rode on as if he had heard nothing. The general was an enigma to most of his troops. One soldier declared him the most American-looking man I ever saw, but an Indiana officer who studied him closely said, "There are no outward signs of greatness. He appears to be a very ordinary man." War correspondents wrote, "All his features expressed determination, particularly the mouth. A very remarkable man such as could not be grown out of America, the concentrated quintessence of Yankeedom. He believes in hard war." And his eyes had a half-wild expression, probably the result of excessive smoking. He looks rather like an anxious man of business than an ideal soldier. A more thoughtful reporter from Cincinnati, who had followed Sherman for hundreds of miles on his southern invasion, wrote, "Above all the men I have met, that strange face of his is the hardest to read. It is a sealed book, even to his friends." The general's pursuit of modesty was almost an obsession. He had recently replied to a prospective biographer, "Desire no notoriety, have endeavored to escape the itching of fame." To a woman who requested a lock of his hair, he replied that his hair was too short to plait and too thin to spare from its natural office. Still, he was not without vanity. He suppressed an unflattering photograph that revealed too many of his wrinkles. Only a few months earlier, a hostile northern press had threatened Sherman's career by charging that he was insane. Southern newspapers had begun to echo that theme in response to the general's introduction of total warfare, a destructive attack upon civilians. Sherman had already declared that the most humane way to end the war was to destroy the South's power to resist by cutting off supplies and manufacturing and by making the civilians' lot so miserable as to break the morale of Confederates at home and in the field. The general sensed a subtle form of intoxication in the troops as they left the city today, an exhilaration he shared, a feeling of something to come, vague and undefined, still full of venture and interest, a devil-may-care feeling pervading officers and men. He thought of the risks of his march. If he failed, the campaign would be condemned as the wild adventure of a crazy fool. Army bands played an odd medley this morning, "Farewell, Farewell, My Own True Love," "Oh, Jenny, Come Tickle Me," "When This Cruel War Is Over," and the general's favorite, "The Blue Juniata." Halts became frequent. Alonzo Brown of the 4th Minnesota said, 10 minutes march and 20 minutes stand still, weight on the left leg and head under wing." Officers fell asleep in their saddles. The general passed men in new uniforms wincing at every step in tight boots, and then ragged brigades, just as they had come from the Georgia mountains and Atlanta trenches, veteran infantry mingling odors of sweat and urine, unwashed bodies, tobacco, whiskey, and old boots, with those of horses, mules, and sun-bleached wagon canvas. The column swarmed with pets. A squirrel named Bun sat on his master's shoulder gnawing hardtack. Old Abe, the war eagle of a Wisconsin regiment, perched on a cannon. Minerva, the screech owl, a pet bear, scores of dogs riding on saddles, wagons, and caissons. It was a lean army, stripped to the bone and ready for action. Sherman had sent his sick and wounded back to his old base in Tennessee. In the spare ranks remaining, many brigades had shrunk to regimental size. It was a rare regiment that could muster as many as 300 of its original 1,000 men. The average company had only 30 men in ranks. Files that had once been 4 abreast had become a single soldier. There were a few green recruits, including an overage victim in his 50s who had lied about his age to deceive a young woman and had been seized by draft officers, the butt of endless jokes by his companions. Though there were many old men in the ranks, most of the soldiers were boys. Thousands were under 18, too young to vote even in the recent election that had kept Abraham Lincoln in the White House. "My little devils," Sherman called these teenaged adventurers. Most of the Army's colonels were under 30. Captains and lieutenants were in their early 20s. The six commanders of armies, corps, and divisions averaged 31 years of age. These troops were taller and stronger than the bluecoats of the Eastern armies and were bearded, long-haired, and tattered, men who marched with a rolling stride, Midwesterners, most of them, sons and grandsons of pioneer settlers of the country from Kentucky to Minnesota, of English, Irish, and Scotch descent, with a sprinkling of Germans and Swedes. Two regiments took their orders and got their band music in German. Several Chippewa Indians marched with the 3rd Wisconsin. Many of the troops bore deep resentment toward Negroes and the agitators whom they blamed for causing the war, for the virus of race prejudice was nationwide. They told rebel prisoners with grim earnestness, "I'd sooner shoot an abolitionist than a Johnny any day." In all, there were 218 regiments, most of them from the West. Ohio had 52 regiments, Illinois 50, Indiana 27, but there were others from Wisconsin, Michigan, Minnesota, Iowa, Missouri, and Kentucky. 33 regiments came from the East, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Connecticut, and Massachusetts. One regiment of white Alabama Unionists rode with the cavalry, hill countrymen of fiercely independent spirit who owned no slaves and refused to side with the arrogant plantation owners of the Low Country. Sherman had made no effort to reform these troops. He left them as he found them, upon taking command, coolly efficient in battle and of free and easy discipline, inclined to treat their officers as if they were schoolteachers, bedeviling them with pranks and practical jokes. The affection of these soldiers for Sherman dated from the beginning of his command, when he canceled dress reviews and reduced formality to a minimum. And it grew after he led them in the slashing campaign into Georgia with a minimum of head-on fighting. The troops traveled lightly, as if they were on an overnight reconnaissance rather than a march through the heart of the South. Each man carried a blanket wrapped in a rubber poncho slung over his shoulder, a haversack, a tin cup hung at the waist, a musket, and a cartridge box with 40 rounds of ammunition. "I doubt," said Private Theodore Upson, an Indiana farm boy, "if such an army as we have ever was got before. All the boys are ready for a meal or a fight, and don't seem to care which it is." In this they were like most citizen soldiers, eager to escape discipline and control of officers, seeking adventure where they found it. Their families back home, like the nation at large, conceived of them as moral, honorable young Americans, ideal products of the world's most enlightened system of government. In fact, they were potentially cruel and heartless pillagers, many of whom awaited only the opportunity to plunder, burn, and rape. Sherman climbed a steep hill crowned by old entrenchments that encircled the city and overlooked a stark, scarred landscape as barren as the face of the moon, a vista of rifle pits hacked into red clay, earthworks bristling with rows of sharpened sticks and piled brush. Irregular ranks of graves marked the tides of Federal advances during the Siege of Atlanta, with headboards made from cracker or ammunition boxes, the names of soldiers crudely scratched on one side, and on the other, Pilot Bread, or Water Fleet Arsenal. The general wheeled for a final glimpse of the city, where a black pall still rose from the ruins. He looked toward the distant village of McDonough and caught sight of a column of Howard's right wing, the gun barrels glistening in the sun, the white-topped wagon stretching away to the south, and right before us the 14th Corps, marching steadily and rapidly, with a cheery look, and swinging past with a stride that made light of the 1,000 miles between us and Richmond. A passing band struck up the battle hymn of the Republic, and the troops joined in the chorus, their echo rolling through the hills, "Glory, glory, hallelujah!" A triumphant roar that Sherman was to remember for the rest of his life. The general was moved by his departure. We turned our horses' heads to the east, Atlanta was soon lost behind the screen of trees and became a thing of the past. Around it clings many a thought of desperate battle, of hope and fear, that now seem like the memory of a dream. He was off on his march to fame. Elsewhere, the war that had dragged on for 3.5 years seemed to have degenerated into a stalemate. Far to the north, in trenches about Richmond and Petersburg, Virginia, the weary armies of U.S. Grant and Robert E. Lee faced each other in siege warfare that promised to be interminable. The Confederacy's strength was being sapped by the blockade of her ports, and the effort to meet superior force on far-flung fronts, but her armies still in the field remained fiercely defiant. The last Federal soldiers were still within sight when a growing horde of Confederate scavengers invaded Atlanta. Men, women, and children swarmed among the smoking ruins, some from as far as 100 miles away. They loaded iron, salt, bacon, sugar, coffee, and hides into wagons, carts, and carriages. The Augusta Constitutionalist reported that our country cousins also ransacked vacant houses. One woman who tugged at a rope tied to a piano leg explained, "I found a mighty nice table in there, and I'm trying to get it in my court." The Georgia Militia General, W.P. Howard, on an inspection tour for Governor Joseph Brown, found 250 loot-filled wagons in the city. Howard also reported the crowning act of villainy by Sherman's men, who had broken gravestones in the city cemetery, dragged bodies from vaults, and replaced them with Federal dead. But Atlanta's revival began with the bizarre scenes of pillage. Within a month, there would be an election for a new mayor and aldermen who were to begin with $1.64 in the treasury. The post office, a newspaper, a grocery, a bar, and a salt factory would open, and trains would be running again. The irony of Confederates looting their ruined city on the heels of Sherman's departure seems to have escaped contemporary observers, but the universality of the impulse to vandalism under such circumstances was to become familiar to Americans in generations to come. The instinct to pillage when pillage was possible was not limited to Sherman's troops nor to the impoverished Southern civilians who scrabbled in the ruins to find the means for a new life. 2. I can make Georgia howl. William Tecumseh Sherman, who was now on the brink of fame at 44, had been born February 8, 1820, in Lancaster, Ohio, the son of a state Supreme Court judge who died when the boy was 9 and left him to be brought up by Thomas Ewing, a wealthy neighbor who was to become his father-in-law and an influential senator. Through Ewing's influence, Sherman went to West Point, where he graduated 6th in the class of 1840, despite so many demerits that he narrowly escaped expulsion. After 13 years in the Army, he married Thomas Ewing's daughter, Ellen, left the service, failed at banking, real estate, and law, and finally became superintendent of Louisiana Military Academy, where the approach of war found him at Christmas 1860. The intensely patriotic Sherman loved the South, where he had formed many friendships, but was emotionally racked by the collapse of the Union. His wife and 5 children were away for the holidays, and he was lonely and depressed, watching the country melting away like a snowball in the sun. Though he wished slavery did not exist, Sherman said he would not abolish or modify it if he could, an opinion widely held at the time by whites, both North and South. "All the Congresses on earth can't make the Negro anything else than what he is," Sherman said, remembering only the illiterate and repressed black slaves he had known in the South. There is no evidence that he had come in contact with educated Negroes. But though he believed in the right of revolution and had been a Southern sympathizer, Sherman felt that secession was absurd. He said firmly, "I will do no act, breathe no word, think no thought hostile to the government of the United States." One night after South Carolina's secession from the Union, Sherman paced the floor of his Louisiana home, literally sobbing with anxiety, regaling his friend Professor David Boyd with an impassioned warning and prophecy. "This country will be drenched in blood. God knows how it will end. Oh, it is all folly, madness, a crime against civilization. You people speak so lightly of war. You don't know what you're talking about. War is a terrible thing. You mistake, too, the people of the North. They are peaceable, but earnest, and will fight, too. You are rushing into war with one of the most powerful, ingeniously mechanical, and determined people on Earth, right at your doors. You are bound to fail. When Louisiana seceded, Sherman parted from his cadets in an emotional scene. Unable to say more, he placed his hand over his heart, blurted, "You're all here," and left. He was soon in Washington, where his brother John, a senator from Ohio, introduced him to Abraham Lincoln as a military expert recently arrived from the South. "Ah, how are they getting along down there?" Lincoln asked. "They think they're getting along swimmingly," Sherman said. "They're preparing for war." "Oh, well," Lincoln said mildly, "I guess we'll manage to keep house." Sherman was disgusted. He dismissed Lincoln as an unimaginative, provincial, and partisan politician who lacked the vision to foresee approaching war. He railed at his brother and all Republican leaders, "You've got things in a hell of a fix, and you may get them out as best you can." He went to St. Louis, where he became president of a streetcar company at a salary of $40 per month. When war was declared, Sherman returned to the White House to volunteer, but to Lincoln's astonishment, the intense Ohioan refused to commission as brigadier general and began as a colonel of regular infantry, so that he could win his stars without becoming a political general beholden to Lincoln's administration. Sherman first saw battle at Bull Run, where he fell back in the federal retreat with his regiment and shielded the army on its panic-stricken flight into Washington. He was one of the last Union officers to leave the Virginia field. A day or so later, when Lincoln came out to visit the army, a disgruntled captain called out, "Mr. President, I have a grievance. This morning I went to speak with Colonel Sherman, and he threatened to shoot me." Lincoln glanced at the grim-faced Sherman. "Threatened to shoot you?" He leaned forward and said in a stage whisper, "Well, if I were you, I wouldn't trust him, for I believe he'd do it." The president's carriage rolled away amid the laughter of the troops. Sherman had serious disciplinary problems. He found it impossible to halt the pillaging of his troops. No curse could be greater than invasion by a volunteer army. No Goths or Vandals ever had less respect for the lives and property of friends and foes, and henceforth we ought never to hope for any friends in Virginia. These were problems that would haunt him until the war's end, that he would never bring himself to resolve. Sherman's ambivalence in the matter of troop discipline stemmed from his conflicting beliefs that war must be made so terrible as to demoralize the enemy, and that troops should never be permitted to victimize the innocent and helpless. Though he had protested that he wished to avoid high rank, Sherman found himself commanding general in Kentucky 3 months later, in direct violation of Lincoln's promise. It was perhaps a result of this bizarre attitude that Sherman was soon contending fiercely with Midwestern politicians who sought to interfere in his command, with his undisciplined troops, and with newspaper reporters he regarded as enemy spies. The general's behavior was so unpredictable that vengeful newspaper correspondents, smarting under his rigid censorship, published false reports that the quixotic general was insane. General Henry Halleck, the pop-eyed commander of the Department of Missouri, sent Sherman home as unfit for duty. The despondent Sherman said he would have committed suicide except for his children. One newspaper reported, "General Sherman, who lately commanded in Kentucky, is said to be insane. It is charitable to think so." Mrs. Sherman wrote Lincoln, insisting that the sensitive and nervous general found the cruel attacks of the press unbearable, and begging the president to transfer her husband to the East. Instead, Sherman was rescued by Halleck himself, who sent him to Paducah, Kentucky, to serve under U.S. Grant, another obscure Army veteran and refugee from civilian life, whose reputation was under a cloud. Grant was said to be a hopeless alcoholic, but he won the first great Union victories in the West at Fort Henry and Fort Donelson, and then commanded at Shiloh, where 100,000 men clashed in the first major battle between the Western armies. Grant won victory by the narrowest of margins, and Sherman's division played a decisive role on the bloody field, standing its ground stubbornly against waves of Confederate attacks, while thousands of other Union troops huddled in fright beneath the bluffs of the Tennessee River. Within a few days, Sherman wore the twin stars of a major general, and high command became more palatable to him. He wrote his wife, Ellen, "I have worked hard to keep down, but somehow I am forced into prominence and might as well submit." Sherman was in the field on the Western Front when he was stricken by the death of his young son, Willie, who had come with his mother to visit the general. Willie succumbed to typhoid fever and left his father grieving for that child on whose future I based all the ambition I ever had. He resolved, he said, to cherish the boy's memory as the cure for the defects which have sullied my character. A major reorganization of the Federal High Command soon thrust Sherman into the eminence he had professed to dread. Lincoln called Henry Halleck, a born staff officer, to Washington as chief of staff. Grant, suddenly famous as the North's only victorious general, was transferred to Virginia as commander-in-chief of the armies, his first assignment to overcome Robert E. Lee and the Confederate Army of Northern Virginia. Sherman was now left in command in the West, and with a burst of energy that revitalized his army, he organized an offensive against Atlanta from the federal base at Chattanooga, Tennessee. He was beginning to develop his theory of total warfare that involved civilians as well as armies, resolved to make war so terrible that the rebels would never again take up arms. The Southern people, he said, though they cannot be made to love us, can be made to fear us and dread the passage of troops through their country. This theme became almost an obsession with a compulsive Sherman. He declared that the people of the South bore a collective responsibility and that the war was not merely an armed uprising. "It is about time the North understood the truth," he wrote. "The entire South, man, woman, and child, is against us." Even so, the complex man whose name was to symbolize the terrors of total warfare had a keen realization of the sufferings he was to impose upon the Southern people. He wrote his daughter Minnie, who was in school in Notre Dame, Indiana, lamenting his role. "Think of how cruel men become in war, when even your papa has to do such acts. Pray every night that the war may end. Hundreds of children like yourself are daily taught to curse my name, and every night thousands kneel in prayer and beseech the Almighty to consign me to perdition." In early May 1864, Sherman moved his army against General Joseph E. Johnston's strongly entrenched Confederates in mountainous terrain at Dalton, Georgia. Though Johnston was a master of defensive strategy, Sherman slipped past the rebel force, maneuvering his army of 100,000 with mobility new to modern warfare, constantly enveloping the enemy, threatening Johnston's rear, artfully flanking and countermarching over a broad front, using roads as a network, shielding all the while the railroad in his rear that was his lifeline. He feinted and flanked his way southward, attacking only when a collision was unavoidable, and fought only one pitched battle at Kennesaw Mountain, Georgia, where he lost 2,500 men in less than an hour. Within a week, Sherman had flanked the position and was on his way to Atlanta. He drove his army relentlessly. To a quartermaster who was not sure he could keep the pace, Sherman barked, "If you don't have my army supplied and keep it supplied, we'll eat your mules up, sir! Eat your mules up!" He shocked the methodical engineer, who asked for 4 days to replace a burned bridge. "Sir, I give you 48 hours, or a position in the front ranks." It was not only Sherman's skill and energy that drove the army forward. He had explored the hills, valleys, and streams in his path as a young officer 20 years before. "I knew more of Georgia than the rebels did," he said. Sherman's leadership during this remarkable campaign was no longer that of the frustrated, erratic, and reluctant officer of the early months of the war. As one of his officers said, "His eccentricities disappeared. His grasp of the situation was firm and clear. His judgment was cool and based upon sound military theory as well as quick practical judgment. His mind seemed never so clear, his confidence never as strong, his spirit never so inspiring, and his temper never so amiable as in the crisis of some fierce struggle." Confederate troops were also bewildered by innovations in federal military equipment during this campaign. For the first time, telegraphers were with the general, bringing him news from distant parts of the field. Engineers who marched ahead of the army made maps that were reproduced in the dark wagons of photographers and hurried to field officers. Wagons carried prefabricated bridges to throw across streams. A Confederate prisoner gaped as Sherman's canvas-covered pontoons were swung across a river by ropes. "Boys," he said, "anybody who could make a bridge out of them dog tents could beat us." Others praised Sherman's tactics. "You can swing around on your hands like a gate. Sherman'll never go to hell. He'll flank the devil and make heaven despite the guards." Johnston skillfully extricated himself from each position, but was forced relentlessly backward into trenches along Peachtree Creek, where he settled to fight for Atlanta. Amid a public clamor for his removal, the proud and stubborn Johnston refused to reveal his plans to Jefferson Davis and was replaced by the erratic Kentuckian John Hood, who had lost the use of his arm at Gettysburg and suffered a maimed leg at Chickamauga and now rode strapped into his saddle. Hood attacked fiercely, and though he routed a Federal corps in front of his trenches and all but overwhelmed one of Sherman's wings near Decatur, was twice defeated with ruinous losses. Sherman cut Hood's last rail supply line in late August, but since he had neither destroyed the enemy army nor taken the city, victory seemed far away. Atlanta, a symbol of Southern resistance, still held out after bloody assaults had been called off and Union troops settled down for a siege. After 3 years of war and sacrifice, Northern civilians felt that the war would never end. Generals and Washington politicians had forecast final victory too often. The South had been penetrated by Union armies before, to little avail. Despite Sherman's finesse, the campaign against Atlanta had cost 31,000 Federal casualties against 35,000 Confederate. There was a rising tide of protest, heightened by reports of even more terrible casualty rolls in Grant's army in Virginia. The campaigns on both fronts seemed destined to drag on without decisive victory, as campaigns had done for 3 years. Abraham Lincoln was so depressed by the public mood and so apprehensive of defeat in the presidential election just 2 months away that he made secret plans to negotiate with the Democratic candidate, General George McClellan, hoping, he said, to save the Union. McClellan, who had won and lost Lincoln's favor as commander in Virginia, promised voters that he would end the bloody stalemate by making peace with the South. A short-lived boom for Sherman excited the Democratic National Convention in Chicago for a day or two. Sherman wrote Halleck, "Some fool seems to have used my name. If forced to choose between the White House and the penitentiary for 4 years, I would say the penitentiary, thank you." Sherman fumed over newspaper reports that he would deliver 99% of his army's votes to McClellan, the invention of some knave, he said, but was even more incensed when McClellan wrote two friendly letters currying his favor after having ignored him throughout the war. After 5 weeks of siege, when Sherman cut the last Confederate rail line in severe fighting, the city was doomed. Hood evacuated Atlanta abruptly, and on September 2nd, Sherman moved his troops swiftly into the city. The Lincoln administration's crisis subsided overnight, and the nation abandoned itself to celebration. Sherman's terse telegram to Washington was greeted as the most welcome and dramatic news of the war to date. Atlanta is ours, and fairly won. Streets of cities and villages throughout the North were thronged with celebrants who sensed that the end of the war was in sight at last, and that sons, brothers, and fathers would soon be coming home. The South had been severed. Only Virginia and the Carolinas remained to support Lee's army in the field. Coupled with Admiral David Farragut's capture of Mobile, Alabama, and General Phil Sheridan's sweep of the Shenandoah Valley in Virginia, Sherman's fate knocked the bottom out of the Chicago platform of the Democrats and assured the reelection of Lincoln. Atlanta headquarters were deluged with newspapers, letters, and telegrams, all praising Sherman and his army. Lincoln offered the nation's gratitude and declared a day of thanksgiving. Henry Halleck declared the campaign was the most brilliant of the war. Grant said it would go down in history as unsurpassed, if not unequaled. The young historian Charles Francis Adams, who was serving with Grant before Richmond, choked back tears of emotion as he read Sherman's dispatch on the fall of Atlanta. The campaign, he said, had unrolled like a sonorous epic, a poem. He rang Sherman with Napoleon and Frederick the Great. Sherman behaved as if he heard none of the chorus of acclaim. His staff saw that he was thinking of the months to come and that he was not to be distracted. He was intent on delivering a final death blow to the South. Already he looked beyond the occupied city, across hundreds of miles to the Atlantic, and then northward to Virginia, where the major Confederate army was intact and defiant. Months earlier, at the opening of the spring campaign, Sherman's inspector general had asked what was to be done after the capture of Atlanta. Sherman whacked ashes and sparks from his cigar and said brusquely, "Salt water! Salt water!" He had no intention of immobilizing his army by garrisoning the conquered city. He would evacuate its remaining civilians, destroy it as a communications center and supply base, and move on. He explained to Halleck that he must move out civilians or arrange to feed them. If the people raise a howl against my barbarity and cruelty, I will answer that war is war and not popularity-seeking. If they want peace, they and their relatives must stop war. To Atlanta's mayor, James Calhoun, an alderman, who protested that the evacuation would doom thousands of civilians to wander homeless through the winter, Sherman said his order was intended not to meet the humanities, but to help end the war. His letter of justification was a fiery statement of his credo. You cannot qualify war in harsher terms than I will. War is cruelty, and you cannot refine it. You might as well appeal against the thunderstorm as against these terrible hardships of war. We don't want your Negroes or your horses or your houses or your land or anything you have, but we do want and will have, first, obedience to the laws of the United States. If it involves the destruction of your improvements, we cannot help it. But, my dear sirs, when peace does come, you may call on me for anything. Then will I share with you the last cracker and watch with you to shield your homes and families against danger from every quarter. To John Hood, who also denounced the studied and ingenious cruelty of the evacuation, Sherman replied, God will judge us in due time, and he will pronounce whether it be more humane to fight with a town full of women and brave people at our back, or to remove them in time to places of safety among their own friends and people. Hood responded with threats, We will fight you to the death. Better die a thousand deaths than submit to live under you and your Negro allies. When this bitter exchange ended, Sherman completed his evacuation of Atlanta, removing 1,600 natives and refugees in preparation for destruction of the city. A visiting Catholic bishop appeared at headquarters and found Sherman brooding over Confederate charges of his inhumanity. To be sure, he said, I have made war vindictively. War is war, and you can make nothing else of it. But Hood knows as well as anyone that I'm not brutal or inhuman. Sherman persisted in his scheme to set off through the heart of the South. At every opportunity, he pressed his plans upon Grant. He had now begun to think of Savannah as the key to his hopes. The possession of the Savannah River, he wrote Grant, is fatal to Southern independence. They may stand the fall of Richmond, but not all of Georgia. If you can whip Lee and I can march to the Atlantic, I think Uncle Abe will give us 20 days' leave of absence to see the young folks. Though he trusted his friend Sherman, the orthodox Grant was slow to accept this bold plan. The commander-in-chief saw the breathtaking possibilities in the success of such a march, but hesitated over the dangers of the unprecedented abandonment of base to sweep through enemy country where little was known of Confederate defenses. Grant and Sherman exchanged telegrams over the prospect for several weeks, as they considered other aspects of the strategic situation. The Confederate President Jefferson Davis added to Sherman's determination to march to Savannah, and perhaps to Grant's resolve to approve it. Davis, though he was ill and aging, campaigned through Georgia in these days at a distance from occupied Atlanta, rousing small-town audiences with defiant oratory, urging civilians to a final sacrificial effort for Southern victory. He promised that Hood would soon strike Sherman's rear, and that the Yankee army would be harried like Napoleon through the Russian snows until at last Confederate flags floated over the Ohio. Sherman read this revelation of rebel plans in Georgia newspapers with amazement, saying that Davis had lost all sense and reason. But as for Hood, he said, Damn him. If he'll go to the Ohio River, I'll give him rations. Let him go north. My business is down south. And Grant, when he read the dire predictions of Davis, commented wryly, that Sherman might suffer the fate of Napoleon in the Russian winter, but added that Davis had failed to make it clear who would furnish the snow. But there were other officers in Washington and on Grant's staff, whose fears peopled the Georgia countryside with Confederate forces of vast size. Ignorant of conditions in Georgia and of the nature of Sherman's troops, these officers beseeched Grant to forbid the move from Atlanta. Few men in the armies, North or South, could foresee that the impending march was to become Sherman's unique contribution to the war and to the modern science of war. In preparation for his move, Sherman sent General George Thomas northward to Tennessee with a strong army, and when the aggressive and unpredictable Hood moved in the same direction with an equally strong force, Sherman followed with the main body of his army. He gave up the chase soon after a sharp clash with Hood at Allatoona Station, then confident that no decisive action was pending in Tennessee. Sherman telegraphed Thomas that he was turning back to make a hole in Georgia, and asked only that Thomas hold Tennessee for 3 months so that he could strike the South a crippling blow. Sherman telegraphed Grant, "Until we can repopulate Georgia, it is useless to occupy it, but the utter destruction of its roads, houses, and people will cripple their military resources. I can make the march and make Georgia howl." This show of confidence merely inspired fresh apprehension in Washington. The timid Halleck joined General Aaron Rawlins, Grant's chief of staff, in a plea to Lincoln, saying that Sherman was about to sacrifice his army. Grant himself raised another objection. A coastal base to supply the army could not be prepared overnight. Sherman replied that his troops would need no supplies and no base as they went smashing things to the sea. The still skeptical commander had visions of catastrophe, probably implanted by Rawlins. "I believe you would be bushwhacked by all the old men, little boys, and such railroad guards as are still left at home." It was only after he was certain that Hood's Confederate forces had returned far to the north into Tennessee, where they were guarded by Thomas, that Grant's fears subsided. At last, after weeks of Sherman's supplications, Grant was persuaded. He advised Lincoln that he considered the planned march to be sound, and telegraphed Sherman, "On reflection, I think better of your proposition. I say, then, go on as you propose." Sherman's inflexible resolve had stood him in good stead once more. Within a few days of granting permission for the march, Grant was visited by a clergyman in his camp near Richmond. Sherman was much on the commander's mind. "Sherman is a most superior general," Grant said. "A good, kind man, too." "But very unrelenting," the minister said, and walking out the path marked for himself, Grant smiled. "Yes," he said, "that is his character." Thoughtful men outside the Confederacy shared an apocalyptic vision of the fate awaiting Sherman's army, surrounded in swamps and woodlands, fired on from fences and hedgerows, and bled to death by bands of Georgia guerrillas. British observers were perplexed by the army's plunge into hostile country. The London Times commented that the mysterious expedition of Sherman, on an unknown route against an undiscoverable enemy, had no parallel since Marlborough's disappearance into Germany to fight the Battle of Blenheim. The editors were dubious of success. The British Army and Navy Gazette said, "He has done either one of the most brilliant or one of the most foolish things ever performed by a military leader." The London Herald declared, "The name of the captor of Atlanta, if he fails now, will become the scoff of mankind and the humiliation of the United States for all time. If he succeeds, it will be written on the tablet of fame." Since Abraham Lincoln feared the London press as a possible catalyst for British intervention in the war, such comments probably increased his reluctance to approve Grant's decision, but the president became almost boyishly enthusiastic once the march had begun. Southern newspapers assailed Sherman on the eve of the march as an Attila and a Judas Iscariot, declaring that his foray would lead him to the paradise of fools. A Richmond minister struck a popular chord for Confederate partisans. "God has put a hook in Sherman's nose and is leading him to destruction." Even Henry Hitchcock was uneasy as he watched the general in final preparations. "This campaign will be no joke. Doubtless it will be death to those of us who fall into their hands." Once Sherman had left Atlanta, only the laconic Abraham Lincoln seemed unconcerned for his safety and confident that the general knew the route to final victory. "I know what hole he went in at." In fact, fears for the army's security were absurd. Georgia lay defenseless before Sherman's horde. The way was open to the east on both northern and southern flanks of the Federal movement. Virtually all able-bodied men over 16 and under 60 were out of the state serving with their regiments. Even most of the planters who lived in the region were to flee as Sherman approached, leaving women, children, and slaves to face the swarming bluecoats. To oppose Sherman's 62,000 disciplined troops, most of them hardened veterans, Georgia could muster but 13,000, most of whom were untested and untrained state militia. These meager forces were divided between Macon and Augusta, which were assumed to be threatened by Sherman. No other cities in eastern Georgia could boast garrisons of respectable size. Sherman had already severed communications with the North. The railroad that had supplied his troops was torn up by his men for many miles outside the city. The lone telegraph line had been cut on November 12th without the gesture of a final telegram to Washington. He had sent his farewell message to Grant more than a week earlier, however, promising a paralyzing blow against Confederate resources. "This may not be war, but rather statesmanship. If the North can march an army right through the South, it is proof positive that the North can prevail." This bore no hint of the terror and atrocities to come during the first passage of a large hostile army through the American countryside, victimizing helpless civilians. It was to be a decade before Sherman offered a justification for his march. "When we took Atlanta, they were bound by every rule of civilized warfare to surrender their cause. It was then hopeless, but they continued the war, and I had a right, under the rules of civilized warfare, to commence a system that would make them feel the power of the government and cause them to succumb." Sherman warned Grant that he should not expect reports for weeks to come. "I will not attempt to send couriers back, but trust the Richmond papers to keep you well advised." About a dozen reporters and artists for northern newspapers and magazines were to make the march with the army, and they would be beyond the reach of telegraph lines until they reached the Atlantic. Sherman was at ease once communication with Washington was severed. No longer did he fear an order to abandon his march. He was now the supreme commander, at large in the field. Unlike most generals in the war, Sherman directed his troops with little delegation of authority. He had no patience with chains of command that interfered with his freedom of action, and so had left his chief of staff in Nashville, Tennessee, long ago. Officers of all services reported to him directly. Paperwork was at a minimum. As one officer noted, the general kept his office in a pocket from which papers were soon discarded. Still, no important details escaped Sherman. One of his last letters before leaving Atlanta was to Admiral David Porter, commander of naval forces along the Atlantic coast. Porter was told to expect the army to appear on the coast somewhere between Savannah and Hilton Head, South Carolina, about Christmas time. His final letter was to his wife, begging that she not worry about him, even at reports of disasters. She was to remember that the only news she could have of him would come through rebel sources. The moves of the army during the first day's march conformed to plans perfected 2 weeks earlier. The columns would move eastward over several parallel roads on a front about 60 miles wide, taking so eccentric a course as to baffle the enemy. Sherman felt that the rebels would defend Macon to the south of his course and Augusta to the north, if only as symbols, and he intended to drive between them toward Savannah. His army would march in two wings, the right or southern wing, under the pious young abolitionist Oliver O. Howard, Old Prayer Book, who had lost an arm in the Virginia fighting. The left, northern wing, was led by Henry Slocum, a New Yorker who had survived a severe wound at Bull Run to command a wing in the victory at Gettysburg. 5,000 cavalry would be concentrated first on the south to screen Howard's infantry in the Macon region. The horsemen were led by Hugh Judson Kilpatrick, known as Kill Cavalry and Little Kill, a hard-driving little dandy with luxuriant sideburns who had been sent down from Virginia by Grant. The artillery carried 65 guns, each drawn by an 8-horse team. More than 25,000 horses and mules would pull wagon trains some 25 miles long, 2,500 wagons and 600 ambulances. Each wing carried pontoon bridges long enough to span the widest rivers in its path. Despite plans to live off the country, the army carried a herd of 10,000 cattle. The troops were to march 15 miles a day, breaking camp before dawn. Each brigade was to send out small foraging parties to gather provisions from farms as they passed. The southern wing marched southeast from Atlanta, feinting in the direction of Macon. The northern wing moved on parallel routes through Decatur and Covington, posing a threat to Augusta. The wings were to approach each other near Milledgeville, Georgia's capital, 100 miles east of Atlanta, and then, providing the way was open, move directly on Savannah. Sherman intended to turn where opportunity beckoned if the capture of Savannah seemed impracticable. Though he had not shared details of his plan with Grant, Sherman intended to halt only briefly in Savannah and then turn northward to march through the Carolinas, destroying Robert E. Lee's last sources of supply for his Army of Northern Virginia. A few days earlier, Sherman had gone over a map with his generals, tracing a route through South Carolina to Columbia, thence northward to Goldsboro, North Carolina, a rail junction near the battlegrounds of Grant and Lee. I believe we can go there, Sherman had said. When we reach Goldsboro, Lee must leave Virginia, and he will be defeated. Sherman had chosen his route after poring over census reports of farm production county by county so that he could lead his troops through the region's richest in provisions. Georgia has 1 million inhabitants, he said. If they can live, we should not starve. Grant expected such resourcefulness of Sherman. He bones all the time while he is awake, as much on horseback as in camp or in his quarters. Among Sherman's jubilant troops as the march began was at least one soldier who would have scoffed at Grant's appraisal. Old Sherman's got the big head now. He's captured Atlanta and thinks he can go wherever he pleases. 3. I'll have to harden my heart. The Army's columns snaked eastward from Atlanta in a pattern that was to become familiar during the epic march of 5 months. Their roads now converged and then diverged. The wings from 20 to 40 miles apart, the outermost units frequently 80 miles apart. Impromptu plans for Confederate defense of Georgia were already collapsing in Sherman's path. Lieutenant General Joseph Wheeler's decimated gray cavalry squadrons, attempting stands to the south and east of Atlanta, were swept aside by Kilpatrick's troopers in brisk, noisy skirmishes at East Point, Rough and Ready, Jonesboro, Stockbridge, Lovejoy, and Bear Creek. Howard's wing pressed eastward toward the crossings of the Okmulgee River. Lieutenant John S. Ashe of the Georgia Hussars reported one of these Confederate disasters. We were so completely run over that we were scattered in every direction, those of us who were not killed or captured. Wheeler could do no more than fall back before overwhelming force, with little prospect of making a stand until the invaders reached the sea, where Savannah's extensive earthworks awaited. Sherman himself planned to move between his columns as the march advanced. He began with Slocum's north wing as it wound through Decatur and past Stone Mountain. Sherman stopped for half an hour in Decatur, a dilapidated village of old houses around a courthouse square, where Manuel, the general's cook, chased chickens in the yard of a large house until a woman emerged to scold him. She was quieted by Colonel Thomas Baylor, the ordnance chief, who bought the flock for the outrageously high price of $1 a head and left the woman with a benign memory of the mercurial Sherman, who exhibited such callousness in hundreds of later incidents as to be remembered in the South as the devil incarnate. In the countryside into which Sherman's army now flowed, Georgia's civilians had begun to meet the invaders. Their reactions ranged from terror and dismay among the whites to hysterical joy among the blacks. At nightfall, young Martha Amanda Quillen watched from her home in Decatur as a line of flaming buildings approached. As far as the eye could reach, the lurid flames of burning buildings lit up the heavens. I could stand out on the veranda and for 2 or 3 miles watch them as they came on. I could mark when they reached the residence of each and every friend on the road. She heard the eternal gab of the Yankee army, and saw outbuildings at each house burst into flames. I heard the wild shout they raised as, torch in hand, they started for the next house. She calculated the distance the burners traveled in an hour, and ascertained almost to the very minute when the torch would be set to our own house. But she was saved by federal officers, who made headquarters in her parlor. Though several torches were brought to the Quillen house, they were stamped out by guards. Martha dreaded the coming of dawn. I prayed that I might never see the destruction, the deep distress the morn would reveal to me. That too is all past, and lives only in memory. But no one, I hope, will ever expect me to love Yankees. Men of the 129th Illinois Regiment, who halted in the village that night, taunted frightened women in the dark houses around them. Why don't you come and see who's here? Campfires were built so close by that the frame buildings caught fire, and women and children dashed out, begging for mercy. Private William Grunert helped to put out the fires, but others were set so rapidly that several houses burned before guards drove the men away. When the regiment left the town at midnight, 2 of its men were shot from the darkness, but the column did not stop to defend itself. A chilly rain began to fall. There was a march Private Grunert did not forget. We would have frozen if the fence on both sides of our route had not been fired and burned by those ahead of us. The heat became so intense that our ambulance wagons had to take to the field. To fulfill General Sherman's order to the letter, several cotton presses and gins and mills were fired during the night, and along the whole route to Atlanta, the sky was red. Sherman's troops soon learned that some women in their path were of indomitable spirit. One farm wife who stood on the porch of her shack with two small boys was hailed by a soldier who carried two of her chickens over his shoulder. "Don't you think we'll end the war soon now?" She looked beyond him to the moving blue columns and said quietly, "Our men will fight you as long as they live, and these boys will fight you when they grow up." Jesse Macy, a Quaker soldier of the 10th Iowa, met a defiant young woman on the porch of a mansion. "My husband is a captain of the Confederate Army, and I'm proud of it," she said. "You can rob us. You can take everything we have. I can live on pine straw the rest of my days. You can kill us, but you can't conquer us." A few miles away, a young woman who watched the army with her mother and sisters was hailed by a passing soldier. "Is your husband in the rebel army?" "Of course." "Was he conscripted?" She spat scornfully. "No, sir. I wouldn't have a man if he had to be conscripted." Federal soldiers were often amazed at the extent of provincial prejudice and ignorance in the rural South. An old woman by the roadside in Jonesboro stared at the soldiers in disbelief. "I swear," she said, "I can make out every last word they utter. They told me so many of you was foreigners I'd never understand the Yankee tongue." In Conyers, an old woman greeted soldiers with complete resignation. "I've run away from you 6 times, clear across the South, starting back in Kentucky. I don't care where you go next. I'm done running. I'm going to let you go first. Maybe I'll follow." Sherman spent the first night of the march at the roadside near the village of Lithonia, from where he could see the granite hulk of Stone Mountain, clearly outlined by the glow of fires that stretched for miles.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.